Today we discuss the disease of the submandibular salivary gland. In previous lecture, we have discussed about the disease of the parotid gland. Now, the salivary glands are exocrine glands whose secretion flow into the oral cavity through ducts. Now, these salivary glands are major salivary glands and minor salivary glands. Now, major salivary glands are those glands like parotid gland, submandibular salivary gland, and the sublingual salivary gland. These are those glands having the ducts. So, those glands which have the ducts, these are called the major salivary glands. And those glands which does not possess the duct, these are the minor salivary glands. These are present in the oral cavity, soft palate, and into the posterior pharyngeal wall. And these minor salivary glands does not possess the duct. That's why the carcinoma, 80% carcinomas arise from these minor salivary glands, and the 20% carcinomas arise from major salivary glands. Now, the major salivary glands, these are the parotid gland, submandibular gland, and sublingual gland. Minor salivary gland, labial and buccal glands, glossopalatine glands, palatine glands, and lingual glands. So, the difference between two is the major salivary gland, you have the duct, whereas the minor salivary gland, you does not have the duct. And in major salivary gland, majority of the tumors are benign, and in minor salivary glands, majority of the tumors are malignant, very, very dangerous one. Now, these minor salivary glands, these are found throughout the oral cavity with the greatest density in the buccal and labial mucosa, the posterior heart palate and tongue base. They are not often observed in the attached gingiva and anterior heart palate mucosa. The majority of these glands are either mucinous or pseudomucinous, except for the serious Ebner glands on the posterior aspect of the tongue. Now, these Ebner glands are very, very important. These are present on the posterior part of the tongue because sometimes they become so protuberant, very, very agonizing for the patient when they inhale the or they take the bolus, that causes the very painful situation. So, these Ebner glands becomes very dominant in case of smokers. The person who smokes, they become very dominant and painful during the swallowing. Now, this submandibular salivary gland. Now, this is the submandibular salivary gland, which is the second largest major salivary gland situated in the anterior part of digestive triangle in the submandibular triangle. Gland is about size of walnut and weight about 7 to 16 grams. Roughly J-shaped and indented by the posterior part of mylohyoid muscle, which divides into large part of superficial to the muscle and small part lying towards the muscle. Now, if you see this picture, this is the submandibular salivary gland. Now, this gland is enveloped by the well-defined capsule, main excretory. Now, you see this is the submandibular salivary gland having the deep lobe and superficial lobe. This is the angle of mandible. Now, angle of mandible is the line where underneath is the deep lobe and superficial, it is the superficial lobe is there. Now, this is the mixed gland with both serous and mucous secret units. Intercalated ducts are shortened compared to the parotid. Steroid ducts are usually longer. Now, the anatomy of submandibular gland, you see this is the submandibular salivary gland. This is the deeper part. This is the superficial part. This one is the mylohyoid muscle, which divides the gland into deeper part and superficial part. This is the lingual nerve is there, and these are the facial veins. You see, this is the two important nerves which lie in the base of tongue. One is the lingual nerve, and another is the hypoglossal nerve, which runs along the Wharton duct. I will show you the Wharton duct, which is very, very important, which always delude the surgeon, and because it zigzag in manner, so very difficult to trace out it. And when you go to the Wharton duct, you will face the lingual nerve and the hypoglossal. So you see this lingual nerve there, just below it you will find the hypoglossal nerve there. Very, very two important nerves which lie underneath of the deep lobe of the submandibular salivary gland. So when you do the surgery, you have to save these two nerves, otherwise there will be the paralysis of the tongue and there will be no sensation over the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. So these are very, very important nerves. And when you do the surgery, you have to ligate the facial vein. And facial artery is also there. Along with this, you have to ligate these both vessels. You see now, this is the very, very important picture where you see the facial nerve is there. Now, facial nerve has the one branch, there is the marginal mandibular nerve, which crosses the superficial bone. Superficial, here you have the marginal mandibular nerve, and over the deep lobe, you have the cervical branch of the facial nerve. Now, this is again very important. You see, this is the submandibular salivary gland is there. Here the parotid gland is the masseter muscle, and this is the mylohyoid muscle, which divides the lobe two parts. Underneath is the deep lobe, and superficial it is the superficial lobe. This is the mylohyoid muscle. Now this gland is enveloped between two layers of deep cervical fascia. Superficial layer is attached to the inferior part of mandible. The inner deep layer is attached to the mylohyoid line. Posterior, these layers fuse in the sphenomandibular ligament, which separates the submandibular gland. You see, this is the submandibular superficial part. These are the mylohyoid vessels. This one is the mylohyoid muscles. Underneath of mylohyoid muscle, you have the deeper part. This is the facial artery, which is very, very important. This is the angle of mandible. Here around the facial artery. So you have to ligate it at the angle of mandible, otherwise there is huge bleeding. You see, facial vein, facial artery, they run parallel over the angle of the mandible. So you have to ligate both vessels. Otherwise there will be very huge bleeding. So you have to ligate while you are dissecting the submandibular salivary gland. These are certain relations. Again, this one is the submandibular salivary gland, this is the facial vein, angular mandible, facial artery. You have ligate here, then you have the skin, then you have the platysma, which is adherent to the gland. This is the again the submandibular fossa of the mandible and insertion of the medial pterygoid muscle. This is the medial lateral pterygoid muscle. This one is the medial pterygoid muscle, hyoid bone, and this is the submandibular salivary gland. Now, this is the facial artery, which runs underneath of the your lateral pterygoid muscle, then deeper part of the submandibular muscle, then over the angle of mandible. So you have to ligate it. You have to ligate. Then this is marginal mandibular nerve, which is a branch of the facial nerve. You have to save this nerve. It is plastered over the surface of the submandibular. You have to separate it along with fascia. Otherwise, there will be the paralysis of the angle of the oral cavity, because this marginal mandibular nerve supplies the angle of the oral cavity to the mandibulus, or the commissure of the oral cavity. So when this nerve gets paralyzed, there will be the drooling of the saliva from the oral cavity. So you have to save this marginal mandibular nerve, which is the branch of the facial nerve. You have to save this facial artery. You have to ligate it. You have at the angle of mandible, and you have to save this marginal mandibular nerve, because it is plastered with the fascia over the submandibular skin. So along with the skin, with the superficial fascia, you have to retract it. You will retract and save the marginal mandibular nerve. Now again, this will show the, this is the lingual nerve, which is very, very important, which lies underneath of the deep fascia. Now this is Wharton duct. Now this is Wharton duct, a submandibular salivary gland. Underneath you will find there the lingual nerve, and below it you will find the hypoglossal nerve. So you have to save it. But that's why this submandibular salivary gland, or the Wharton duct, it is a very deluding duct. It just misleads the surgeon, because it's tortuous course, it is zigzag course. So you have to follow it very precise manner, and you have to save this lingual nerve. If you damage this lingual nerve, then there will be the no sensation over the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. And this lingual nerve also carries the fibers of the carta tympani. So there'll be no taste over the anterior two-third of tongue. So this is a very miserable condition. So you have to save this nerve at any cost. That's why this Wharton duct, a duct which carries the saliva from submandibular salivary gland into the oral cavity, it is known as a very notorious in designs. We're deluding, it misleads the doctor or surgeon. So you have to keep in mind facial nerve is underneath of this Wharton duct. Then you have the hypoglossal nerve. You have to save these two nerves. You see, this is hypoglossal nerve, very important nerve, which underneath of the deep lobe of the salivary gland. You have to save these two nerves. Otherwise, if you damage the hypoglossal nerve, there will be the paralysis of the muscles of tongue. So this is very, very important. This is very, very important because Wharton duct always delude the surgeon to take the another path. It's mislead the surgeon because of the zigzag phenomenon of this Wharton duct. So you have to save these two nerves. And this is the parasympathetic ganglion. You see, this is the ganglion. You know the parasympathetic ganglion. These are those ganglions which are secreted to motor in nature. The stimulation that causes the increase in the secretion. If you damage it, then there will be no secretion from the glands. Again, you see this is the submandibular salivary gland is there, and this is the submandibular salivary gland. You know, this is lingual nerve, very, very important nerve. This is the Wharton duct, which opens at the frenulum, the side of the frenulum. This is for the under surface of tongue. You see, underneath of the Wharton duct, you have the lingual nerve, intertwined with each other, very, very difficult to take on. That's why we call the Wharton duct as a deluding duct, the tortuous duct as a very complicated duct. Because you have to save this lingual nerve. My aim to show you this picture, to show you the lingual nerve. You have to save the lingual nerve, otherwise there will be no taste on the anterior two-third of tongue, and there will be no sensation over the anterior two-third of the tongue. Again, I will show you this part. This is Wharton duct. Now here very clear, lingual nerve underneath of the Wharton duct. This is the lingual nerve, which is very, very close to the Wharton duct. Wharton duct lies just over the lingual nerve. Here you have to save it. You have to save, otherwise there will be the loss of sensation and loss of taste over the anterior two-third of the tongue. Now this is the duct. It opens on the floor of mouth on the summit of sublingual papillae at the site of the frenulum tongue. Now this is the frenulum. You see, this is the frenulum. A frenulum, this is the connective tissues which runs over the inter surface of tongue and in the oral cavity. This is the frenulum, which helps in the movement of the tongue, which guards the movement of tongue. So over there, lateral side, there's opening of the submandibular salivary gland. If you see, this is opening, this is the opening, left and right opening of both submandibular salivary gland ducts or Wharton duct. Again, see this picture. This is the frenulum, the connective tissues, which are attached over the base, the under surface of tongue and in the oral cavity. And the function of frenulum is to guard the movement of the tongue, and this is the opening of the Wharton duct or the submandibular salivary duct. Now the facial artery, very, very important artery. You have, this is the facial artery. This is angle of mandible. You have to ligate here. You have to ligate the facial artery here as well as from here. If you ligate the facial artery here, then they'll be bleeding from here. So you have to ligate the facial artery, facial vein, just over the angle of mandible and just over here, over the just near the chin. You have to ligate on both sides, then you will remove the. If you retract it, you can retract it also, but it's better you should ligate this artery before doing the surgery, otherwise there is a lot of bleeding. Now these are the veins which are present over the submandibular salivary gland. Now this is the lymph nodes. Lymph nodes are very, very important. You see, these are the submandibular lymph nodes which are present over the submandibular ciliary gland. Nerve supply, supplied by branches from the submandibular ganglion. These are secretomotor fibers. Secretomotor fibers and those fibers which cause the secretion of the salivary glands. These are known as secretomotor fibers or parasympathetic fibers. These cause the secretion of the salivary glands. These are the parasympathetic fibers are known as the secretomotor fibers. Number two, sensory fibers from the lingual nerve and vasomotor sympathetic fibers from the plexus on the facial artery. And the sympathetic branches, they run over the facial artery and supply the salivary gland. Now these are the secretomotor pathway begins in the superior salivary nucleus. This is the superior salivary nucleus. Then the preganglionic fibers pass through the sensory root of facial nerve, the geniculate ganglion, facial nerve, the caudal tympani, and the lingual nerve to reach the submandibular gland. Postganglionic fibers emerge from the ganglion into the submandibular salivary gland. So this is the parasympathetic system of the salivary glands by supplied by parasympathetic and sympathetic. Parasympathetic is very, very important because it causes the secretion of the salivary gland. It's very, very important. Now we will turn now over the pathologies. The evaluation of the gland symptoms, indicator of salivary gland disorders are limited in number and generally non-specific. Patient usually complain of swelling, pain, xerostomia, foul taste, and sometimes siluria or excessive salivation. Now the swelling and pain. Whenever there is the disease of the salivary gland, as there is the stagnation of saliva, which causes swelling and pain because of pressure over the nerve receptor. Xerostomia is because of the blockage of the secretion into the oral cavity. Xerostomia means dryness of the oral cavity. Foul taste, very, very important. Foul taste means perverted taste. Patient has a very bad taste instead of having the good meal. Now the reason of foul taste is that when there is the xerostomia, then there's invitation of the bacteria, which are normal commensal of oral cavity, which causes the problem over the tongue. And number two, this due to the swelling of ducts, that causes the pressure over the cauda tympani, which does not carry the fibers. Now, despite the prevalence of modern technology in the identification of salivary gland disorders, detailed history is very, very important. Physical examination still plays a significant role in the clinical diagnosis. History is very important. Attentive listening in patients is required for subsequent diagnosis. Medical profile of patient can provide helpful clues as dysfunction of salivary gland is often associated with certain system disorders, such as diabetes mellitus, arteriosclerosis, hormonal imbalance, and neurological disorders. Now, diabetes mellitus is because atherosclerosis, the supply of blood hampered to the salivary glands. Then the hormone imbalance, suppose the hypothyroidism there, so deposition of fat also causes swelling of the glands and loss of secretions. Now, factors of age group and gender are also important. Drug history of patients should also be considered for salivary function is often affected by drug use. Like if a patient is using the nicotine, cigarette smoking, or other, or the pan chala gutka, which causes the submucous fibrosis and narrowing of the ducts of the salivary glands, which causes the storage of secretion into the parotid glands, then invites the bacteria and causes the inflammation. So this is, you see, pan chala gutka is very, very important. It has effect over the salivary glands because of the submucous fibrosis. Submucous fibrosis means lay down of the fiber tissues in the oral cavity, which causes the narrowing of oral cavity. And lesser vascularization of oral cavity and narrowing of the salivary gland ducts. Now, a careful dietary and nutrition history should be obtained. Swelling and pain during meals followed by reduction in symptoms after meals may indicate partial ductal stenosis. Now, if the duct is partially closed, then during the meal, because of increased secretion, there will be swelling and pain. And with passage of time, with the secretion, they get down into the oral cavity and the pain subsides. So this is very important. If a patient complains of pain and swelling during the meal, it means there is problem of the parotid glands. History of prior radiation therapy to head and neck is very, very important, because this radiation also causes the blockage of the vessels, aneurysm of the vessels. Now the physical examination is very, very important. Initial inspection, careful examination of head and neck region, both intra and extraorally. Extraoral inspection, patient should stand 3 feet away and directly face in front of examiner. Inspect symmetry, color, possible pulsation, and discharge occurs on both side of patient, because these ducts open into the oral cavity. So you have to look into the oral cavity, see the duct, because submandibular cerebellum opens into the oral cavity at the site of the frenulum. So you have to ask the patient to take the tongue upward and then see the opening of duct, and then massage the submandibular cerebellar gland. If there is any inflammation, infection, pus will ooze out from the duct. Then the enlargement of submandibular gland may occur on one side or both sides, depending upon the involvement. Now, submandibular swelling present first medial and inferior to the angular mandible. Submandibular swelling differentiate from the lymphatic swelling as being single, larger, and you see how you will differentiate it, whether it is the swelling of the submandibular swelling or it is swelling of the gland, the lymph node. Now the lymph node is differentiated from the submandibular swelling gland, because lymphatic swelling, it is single, it is larger, and it is smoother, and it is just over the angle of mandible, not underneath of angle of mandible. It will be over the angle of mandible. Now, intraoral inspection, proper lightening should be there. Assessment of Wharton duct orifice at the root of the tongue. Wharton duct, it is the duct of the submandibular salivary gland. Now, this is the Wharton duct. If you see, this is the Wharton duct. This is the frenulum, that is the connective tissue under the surface of the tongue, frenulum. This is the Wharton duct. So proper lightening, assessment of Wharton duct orifice at the root of tongue, deepening of the mucosa around the duct with an air blower, and then pressing on the corresponding gland, which allow the examiner to assess the flow or lack of flow of saliva. Now this is the extraoral. Exam based in front of patient. Patient head is inclined forward to maximally expose the parotid and submandibular gland region. Observe salivary gland swelling. Do not rise with swelling, pharyngeal gland, and laryngeal swelling. Now, the difference between the thyroid and laryngeal, if ask the patient to swallow, the laryngeal swelling that move upward, thyroid swelling that move upward, but the swelling of the submandibular salivary gland does not move with the swallowing. Biminimal palpation, extraorally with one hand and intraorally with other hand to examine submandibular gland. One or two gloved finger should be inserted intraorally to palpate the gland and main excretor intraorally, while using the other hand to extraorally support the head and neck. So one hand is given underneath of the mandible to press the gland upward, and another finger over the intraorally to see the swelling. Biminimal palpation by rolling hands over the gland, both intraorally and extraorally, subtle mass lesion can be identified. In the submandibular gland, gland can often be distinguished from pathology within the gland by using this technique. Increased salivation from duct orifice due to pressure extraorally applied to the gland may induce inflammation. Now, differentiating between submandibular gland and the salivary gland and lymph node, the salivary gland can be palpated biminimally. So if you palpate the gland, one finger in the oral cavity, the other over the neck, you can palpate the salivary gland as it extends into the floor of the mouth. Lymph nodes are only filled below the mandible. Lymph nodes may be multiple and a space separate from them from the mandible. So there is a space between the mandible and lymph nodes. This is very important. Lymph nodes may be multiple and a space separate them from the mandible. Radiological and endoscopic examination, plain film xylography, radiography, xylography. Xylography is where you will put the dye and see the picture of the ducts inside the gland and outside. Ultrasonography, computed tomography, magnetic resonance imaging, cell endoscopy, and radionuclear surgery imaging. Now, xylolith means stone. Lith means stone. Stone in the salivary gland. Xylolith are typically calcified organic masses that form within the excretory system of the major salivary gland. So these stones are always present in the major salivary gland, like the parotid, submandibular, and lingual salivary gland. So these xylolith, lith means stones. Xyloliths are typically calcified organic masses that form within the salivary secretory system of major salivary glands. You see, this is the stone in the duct. This is the stone. Most commonly occur in submandibular gland, 80 to 90%, because it has the mucinous spectrum much more, whereas in the parotid gland it is serous secretion. Now, due to tortuous course of Wharton duct, which I call you that this Wharton duct, it misguides the doctor, it misguides the surgeon. It is a deluding phenomena which delude the surgeon. Dependent position of submandibular salivary gland that leaves them prone to stresses, high calcium and phosphate levels, increased mucus, nature of secretion. You see, the stones are common in submandibular salivary gland because, number first, please note down this picture, very, very important. Sometimes they might ask you the question, or they say in the paper, write down the factor which causes the stone formation in the submandibular salivary gland. Number first is the tortuous course of Wharton duct. Tortuous course of Wharton duct, which causes stay of the secretions. Number two, dependent position of submandibular salivary gland that leaves them prone to stresses. So stay of secretions due to the zigzag phenomena of the duct, that causes the stay of secretion. Number two, higher calcium and phosphate levels. So the secretion of their submandibular salivary gland, they have the higher level of calcium and the phosphate levels which stay over there. Then the increased mucoid nature of secretion. It is very mucoid nature, less amount of serous secretion. Clinical presentation, history of acute colchi, perperineal pain, and intermittent swelling of the salivary gland. Degree of septums depend on extent of salivary duct obstruction and the presence of second invasion. Perperineal, perineal means meal. Meal, pain during the meal. Now the salivary gland swelling will be evident upon eating since the stone completely or partially blocks the flow of salivary, resulting in salivary pooling within the gland duct system. If there is commencement of infection, there may be suppurative or non-suppurative expression damage, erythema or warm in oolangus skin. Diagnosis, plain film radiographs are helpful to visualize the cellulite. Occlusal radiograph taken at 90 degrees from floor of mouth, submandibular cellulite. Conventional and contrast cellography, ultrasound, non-contrast CT scan, CBCT, MRI and salivary endoscopy. These are certain investigations. Now this is the mandibular ocular view revealing the homogeneous radiopropistin flow of the mouth. So this is the X-ray plan, mandibular occlusive view. We show the stone in the oral cavity. You see, this is the root of the tongue, where you will get the stone in the oral cavity. This is the OPG, and that will show again the stone is there. This one, orthopentogram or OPG, you can say the OPG or orthopentogram, which also shows there the stone formation. Now the treatment in acute phase, you have the supportive therapy, standard treatment use of analgesics, hydration. Hydration is very, very important. Hydration is very, very important to clean the ducts. So you have to hydrate the patient. Analgesics, hydration, antibiotics and antibiotics as necessary. Salivox, massage and heat applied. At the orifice, transferred by milking the gland. Deeper stones, conventional surgery and salivadenoscopy and extracorporeal show short wave lithotripsy. Conclusion, salivary glands are the important glands of the oral cavity which produce saliva, an essential fluid required for normal mastication, swallowing, digestion, and above all to maintain the normal integrity of oral mucosa and teeth. This saliva is necessary to keep your oral cavity moist. Otherwise, there will be the tear or sometimes the pathogens come over there. Proper knowledge about the normal anatomy and function of the gland is necessary to diagnose any pathology present. Careful history taking and clinical evaluation will help in the early diagnosis and treatment of the salivary gland disease. Thank you very much. If any question regarding the salivary glands, thank you very much.